As summer ends and fall begins, the harvest in the Red River Valley gets underway. And in churches everywhere, another harvest is about to begin. As the sun sets on the Great Plains, the Heartland prepares to reach out to another world. Good evening, and welcome to Angola, Africa. We decided to come to this part of the world because every winter in church basements, many of you make hundreds of quilts which go around the world to people in need. Many of those quilts arrive here in Angola. Tonight we will bring you the stories of the people from Angola. There are stories of despair, stories of hope. For the people here, it's a struggle to survive, but many of you have been helping them. And tonight, you will meet those people who are benefiting from your hours of caring. In a small rural church basement, there is the smell of coffee and the sound of quilters. The women of North Buffalo Lutheran Church near Cragness, Minnesota, have gathered, as they have for decades, to sew the squares. These are threads of compassion.
How many blue ones do we need, Grandma?
For hours they will work, cutting, piecing, sewing, their hands creating something that will mean so much to someone living a world away. The women often wonder where their quilts go, who gets them. Tonight, they will see this colorful quilt in the hands of a thankful friend in Angola, Africa. These are the faces of Angola, people who are experiencing a life of war, hunger, and uncertainty. Luena, Angola, what once was a beautiful and rich Portuguese colonial village, has been reduced to near rubble. And because of a 20-year civil war that does not seem to end, this town of 20,000 has grown to over 150,000. War refugees fleeing their small villages have come here to survive. Some of the 2 million left homeless from what is called Africa's longest war. Angola's savanna has been stripped of its wild animals, slaughtered during the war. With huge supplies of oil and diamonds, Angola should be Africa's richest country. But war has left her in ruins and her people traumatized. The problem is these refugees cannot return home. The rebel group, UNITA, controls much of their homeland, and mines have been buried everywhere. Roads into and out of this village have been impassable. The people here are virtually trapped. An estimated 10 million mines are planted in Angola, many of them here in around Luena. The villagers must try to live with this every day. The risks are great. But every day, the women must gather wood and water to feed their families. So each day is a gamble. That is why a London-based humanitarian group called MAG has arrived in Angola. The Mines Advisory Group came to this village because so many people have been dying or maimed in mine explosions. In the area we visited, 23 active minefields threaten villagers every day.
Now, it can be frustrating. Just because of the needless sort of waste of people's lives being ruined. But then what you're doing is trying to change that so it's positive. You never feel like, well, we're not going to get anywhere, we're not going to do anything. Because every mine we lift is potentially one less amputee or one less child killed.
That is why MAG is training Angolans to find landmines in their villages and explode them. In this village, it is a risk to walk and gather food. The government left no maps of the mines it buried. They could be anywhere.
The scale of the problem is unbelievable.
A cruel reminder how senseless this war between the government and the rebels has become. While the gunfire has stopped for now, the mines have left the city under siege.
Basically, the city's ringed by mines put down by the government to keep UNITA out. On the outside of those rings, UNITA have laid mines to keep the government in. It's a third world country. Apart from organizations like MAG and the other demining organizations, there's no one to help them.
Here, a Soviet-made landmine with a tripwire, waiting for its next innocent victim. Other live mines are buried next to grass huts, posing an everyday threat to human life.
In these five or six houses here since 1992, they've had seven people who've been victims to mines. Four were killed outright, and three were amputees. The mines used to come up to here. This is where they stopped. The guy who lived in this house actually made a barbed wire fence about 2 meters out around his house to try and keep his children in and out of the minefield.
This family lost their grandson, who left behind five children. Several of their neighbors have been killed or maimed. We are scared to even live here, she says. All we want to do is to be free to farm.
This is just terror, really.
At times, anti-tank mines are teamed with anti-personnel mines. The result is devastating, a huge hole and a dead villager. 10 million mines have been buried in Angola. All MAG can do is search every inch of land, find the mines, and blow them up. It takes just one visit to the village hospital. Rooms are packed with those who have fallen victim to the mines, innocent civilians. The death traps do not discriminate. The very young, women, some who are not expected to even survive. Hospital, the conditions are pathetic. No electricity, water. The halls are as dark as the stories here. Families care for their own in rooms often without mattresses. Sometimes quilts from our area provide the only comfort to those injured or dying. In one room, 20-year-old Eduardo Muzala is recovering after he stepped on a mine while on his way to fish for food in the river. He's never been to school, and he tells us his life now will be one of misery because he stepped on the mine. 37-year-old Joao Luaca stepped on a mine searching for food to feed his four children. He hopes to get an artificial leg one day. Her head resting on a quilt, this woman's eyes tell the story of this civil war. A landmine took one leg, injured the other, and both her arms. We all wonder if she will make it. She is a symbol of everything that is wrong with this war. Quilts are everywhere throughout the hospital, sent here from area churches. Those who lay on the floor dying of malaria, or the very young who are starving, are kept warm. This Belgian nurse is volunteering here. The group Doctors Without Borders staff the hospital, since there are no Angolan physicians left here. It can be a struggle for them, just keeping people alive.
For me, it's a good feeling, yes. Very important.
Her concern tonight, the three-year-old she hopes to bring back from starvation. It's a story she's told too often.
Thank you. Back at the North Buffalo Lutheran Church in rural Cragness, Minnesota, the quilt is starting to take shape. Each year, women in hundreds of churches patiently piece together quilts that travel around the world. The volunteers spend countless hours to make this human connection with another culture, another person in need. The art is passed on from generation to generation. So is the passion and the hope for those who get these gifts.
Vic, what'd you say?
Hands are tired, eyes strained, but the finishing touches are put on the quilt. It is then tied.
I used to watch my mother do this, and she'd sew these scraps and sew these scraps, but they say you become your mother, and I think I've done it.
And before it is packed and shipped with the others, a message for Africa.
This is North Buffalo Church. We made this quilt with love. God bless you. I'm going to put it in this pocket here. I wonder what they'll think with all those colors.
The quilt is complete. A quilt of colors on its way to Angola. It will make the long journey.
So what I want you to think about today is all of the ways a quilt might be used by the people that get the quilts.
Finally, the quilt is blessed at a North Buffalo church service before heading out to another part of the world. From here it traveled to Minneapolis, where thousands of quilts are bound together for shipment. From there, a long trip across the Atlantic, months later arriving in an Angolan port city. And because so many of the roads are still mined and under rebel control, humanitarian groups must fly in the quilts for now, along with life-saving food. In the eastern Angolan city of Luena, there are still vivid reminders of the Civil War. Soviet war vehicles have been left to rust. Angolan soldiers still guard against rebel forces. A two-man crude army post is found near the village. Since so much land is mined or under rebel UNITA control, thousands of refugees have found shelter in the old Portuguese colony of Luena. Once victims of the slave trade, the survival of the people now depends on the willingness of the rebels and the government to find peace. The train station is home to hundreds. It is here where Julia makes her home in the corner of a train car, barely room for her and her six children. She lost many family members during the recent war. I can't go home, she says. The war has not ended. The war has taken everything. My children are cold and hungry at night. I'm afraid my children will grow up in war. A state-of-the-art theater built by the Portuguese colonists now stages a real human drama. Hundreds of refugees crowding in here. Gunny sacks form walls for families who cannot go home because of war. Missile and bullet holes riddle the walls. But everywhere you look, there are children smiling. And in all these camps, signs of help and hope from the heartland. Quilts, hundreds of them, keeping people warm. Sometimes the only covering a family has at night. What is the future for the children of Angola? Will they know nothing but war? Children like 12-year-old Nevish. His father was killed in the war, and Nevish lost his leg after rebel soldiers burst into his family's hut, firing bullets into his young leg. With a somber face today, he tells us he wants to go to school one day, and he wants the war to stop. He stands in the middle of what was a recent bloody battle. Africans against Africans. Today, Nevish can only wonder what is ahead for him, for his people.
There are many areas of this village that create a sense of hopelessness. For over three decades, the people here have known nothing but war. First, the War of Independence from Portugal, and then 20 years of civil war. Attempts at long-lasting peace have failed, and the people are afraid to go home.
But there is hope. Lutheran World Relief, for example, has started this sewing center for villagers who lost their legs in mine explosions. It is hoped they can be trained to make clothing, to make something of their life. It is a sobering sight. Some here are missing both legs. This training may be the one hope for these people who have been maimed by the mines. 21-year-old Joao Luiz stepped on a mine while fleeing from the attacking UNITA rebel soldiers. And then there's Isabel Dominguez. She is the mother of six. Her husband left her when she stepped on a landmine. Most of her family died in the minefields as they tried to escape the war. She lost her leg and the baby she was carrying. I thought I was dead, she tells us. Because I lost a leg and I am a woman, I am nothing. Every day she walks to the sewing center. It is the one hope for her future. She says she can't be angry with God because he saved her life when the mine exploded. She now prays every day that help will come for her, her children. Lutheran World Federation and Lutheran World Relief are also helping war orphans get an education. Schools made of wood and grass are a start. And at this orphanage in the village, 60 boys, victims of war, wait for gifts from you. Homemade school bags with paper, pencils, and crayons. For them, it's like gold. Inside, their beds are covered with quilts given by many of you. Tattered and torn from years of use, it's all the children have. And as humanitarian groups clear landmines, refugees are able to settle back in their villages. They are looking ahead. New grass huts are being built on former battlegrounds. Schools and clinics are going up. Everyone hoping peace will last. And to help these people help themselves, seed is distributed to villagers so they can begin to grow crops again on land now cleared of mines. They are desperate for food, and tempers flare at these distribution sites as villagers clamor for seed. But the effort is paying off, teaching the villagers to help themselves, telling them dependency on the UN and aid groups is not a forever.
So you have to, from the start, you have to instill in the people that they have to work themselves to get ahead, that we're here just to help, to push them along, or to pull them, or and to work side by side with them, and to give them some help so they can get on their own feet and do the work themselves. If you just keep giving them material aid all the time, you build this kind of a dependency syndrome which will not go away.
Because peace is so fragile, the UN has a strong presence here, a 7,500-member peacekeeping force. They, along with the humanitarian groups, see to it that guns are silent and people are fed. Tons of food are flown in every week. Hungry children cheer when corn and grain arrive at the refugee centers. There is also anticipation today because word has spread. The quilts are arriving. This morning is like no other. Many villagers have been waiting for it, the day for the people of Angola to get their quilts. Off the UN plane come garden rakes for the villagers, then the quilts. It is time to distribute the quilts. Nevish, the little boy you met, is there. So is Julia from the train car. The young amputee from the sewing center. And Isabel, all waiting patiently, hoping their family will go home with a gift from women in the Red River Valley.
João Luiz!
They beam with pride as they accept the quilts. And remember the colorful quilt we saw made in the country church near Cragness? It went to Julia, her first quilt. Those we seldom saw smile today showed great emotion as they held the quilts. Message from one mother to another.
We made this quilt with love. God bless you.
Everywhere we traveled to in nearby villages, we saw quilts. The quilts are found on the floors of grass huts, used as sleeping mats at schools, to comfort babies just hours old, born in a post-war clinic. And what a sight to see. Hundreds of quilts spread out near the village river. They are washed and left to dry in the sun every day. Looking at this patchwork of quilts, there is no doubt they are used and appreciated. Many refugee families use one quilt for a whole family, and in some cases, the quilts are life-saving.
The quilts have been extremely important, especially during the cold season. It gets cold and damp here, and we have no other source of blankets or those type of materials, and have been very handy, and I'm sure the quilts have saved a lot of lives of these kids, stopped them from getting TB, or if they have malaria, stopped them from getting worse.
Perhaps the most moving visit for us came when quilts from area churches found their way to the hospital. Darkness became light as mine victims received a small comfort from the women of North Buffalo Church. The quilts brought smiles to the war-torn faces of Angola, to people just wanting to live in peace and be free. On this night, the hot African sun began to set on Angola's savannah. Women gathered wood. Darkness began to fall upon the refugee camps. Inside her train car, Julia tucked her children goodnight with the quilt we saw made with threads of love thousands of miles from here. It still smelled new. It is her first quilt, and from now on, it will keep her family warm.
Puts things into perspective as to how lucky we really are. We're rich.
When a person has so much, to think that a blanket would be something you would need that badly, I don't think it's something I can imagine.
We have so much, and we need to be very grateful for that. And we need to be thankful that we can do this work and send these things to other people who need them.
Outside Julia's train car, the African sky is stormy tonight. Lightning shatters the darkness. Smoky fires fill the railroad yard. And as we say goodbye to Angola, we are reminded why we came, to witness the hope these people have in all their despair, the hope for an end to war, a future for their children, a tomorrow they can look forward to. It is evening in Africa, and the children are singing. And it is a song of hope that tonight we can hear across an ocean.